wire been in this until we see?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, that's another two. Okay, just want to make sure.
We're not going to use it until after this is done.
Okay.
How are you?
He's the one that got the mic on there.
Oh, okay.
Okay. That'll be your guy.
I'm just using the house system until the next thing comes.
This is for real.
Welcome back, everyone. I'd like to introduce
introduce Christopher Walker from Greenberg Traurig, who is going to introduce the mayor. Chris?
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Can you all hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so on January 2nd, 2018, Keisha Lance Bottoms was sworn in as the 60th mayor of Atlanta. During Mayor Bottoms' inaugural address, she announced the priorities of her first 100 days in office. Included among those priorities were criminal justice reform, education, and transparency. Less than 2 months into her administration, Mayor Bottoms has already taken measurable action to address the first two. She signed into law a city ordinance eliminating cash bonds to secure the release in the city of Atlanta detention center following an arrest for violations of city ordinances. She also, as recently as Tuesday, signed an ordinance transferring deeds for 31 properties to Atlanta Public Schools. Today, we will hear about her plan to tackle the third, transparency. As the first mayor in Atlanta's recent history to have served in all three branches of government, first as a judge in Fulton County, then as a legislator on the Atlanta City Council, and now as the head of the executive branch, Mayor Bottoms is particularly attuned to the importance of open government and transparency. Mayor Bottoms strongly believes that transparency enables good government and that the best cure for a lack of transparency is sunshine, particularly with respect to the city's contracting and procurement process. During her campaign, Mayor Bottoms announced her commitment to introduce a sweeping ethics and transparency reform package, which will set the framework for a complete overhaul of how the city collects and shares data and information with the media and the public. We are thrilled to have Mayor Bottoms with us today to share with us her vision for a more transparent government. It is my great honor and privilege to introduce to you a woman of intentionality, commitment, and leadership, the Honorable Keisha Lance Bottoms.
I'll just move here so all of you all can see me. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, good afternoon. I can tell you it's a lot of pressure being here. I see a couple of my former bosses, so that's a lot of pressure in and of itself. I know Rains Carter is here from the city solicitor's office, and also I see Tom Cuffey. And I get to wear all of my hats today, and I just want to acknowledge our city attorney, Jeremy Berry, and also Amber Robinson is around here somewhere, and Chris and I had the pleasure of working together quite a bit. We were laughing before I came in. I said, the story of this campaign really is told in my hair. If you Google, at the beginning of the campaign, I had a lot of hair, and by the end, I pulled it all out. So, but it is such a pleasure to be here. The last time I was here with, 50 of my closest friends. We were all here running for mayor. So it's good to be here as a winner. And I get to wear all of my hats here today. But I remember the last time I was here was so interesting because it really was one of our early clashes in the campaign, and who knew? I thought that day was spirited. I had no idea what would come into play over the next few months. But it was great to be here to speak to all of you all, and certainly great to be here to wear all of my hats today. I was a journalism major at Florida A&M University, and I ended up going to law school really by accident. And the interesting part of this story that many people don't know, our former city council president, Cesar Mitchell, and I were good friends in college. And he really was the reason I ended up going to law school. I didn't want to work in a small town after college. I was in school in Tallahassee, and I hated living in a small town. And so I needed to prolong my life a little bit as a student. And there were a group of folk who were applying to law school. And I remember thinking, oh, we're doing that now? Okay, well, I can do that too. But really, for me, it was about the level of expectation being raised, because I didn't know a lot of people who who were attending law school at that time. And when I saw people around me who were headed into the legal field, I said, well, why not? I'll try it out. And when I got to law school, I was 21 years old at Georgia State University. And I remember sitting in civil procedure very confused because I'd never even signed a lease. And I couldn't put into context anything that I was hearing in that class. And for many years, I wondered what going to law school was all about. And as best I could tell, it was about meeting my husband my first year of law school. But now, on the other side, I've said as a member of city council for 8 years, I really had an opportunity to use my law degree in a way that I'd not used it in any number of years practicing law, any number of years as a magistrate over in Fulton County. And it is because we do think differently about everything. And there certainly is value in our law degree beyond practicing law. And what's interesting, being in City Hall 8 years as a member of City Council and now as mayor, I am sometimes really astounded at the limitations of thought. Meaning, when we think about things like ethics and transparency, it really strikes me sometimes at the risk that people are willing to take. And the litmus test that I've always had for any of my staff has been, what would it look like if the I team were chasing you with a camera? And it sounds very simple, but that really is a good measure. If it won't look good on TV, if it won't look good in the newspaper, then you probably shouldn't do it. And I think that as we talk about all of the things that are happening in the city of Atlanta, especially as it relates to our procurement system, that really is a very basic principle that we have to consider. Will it stand the test? Will it stand the smell test? And it's interesting looking at where we are with our procurement issues that many of you all are well aware of, as we know that there is an investigation into procurement. One of the things that we talked about when we were here just last year was this debate between, is there an issue with people or is there an issue with the process? And that is something that we are still working to sort out. We know that there have been some issues with people, obviously, anytime you have the U.S. attorney handing down indictments, but also where are we with our process? So what I've done in the city of Atlanta, I was sworn in January 2nd. One of the first things that I did was to convene a transition committee. This transition committee is comprised of 38 people who represent so many sectors across Atlanta, but many of them are corporate CEOs. And I thought it important that I convene a transition team comprised of people who run organizations, especially high-functioning organizations, because they are in the business of making sure that things are run well and run above board. And with this transition team, we have broken down into various subcommittees, including a subcommittee that will address policy issues such as criminal justice reform. And one of the recommendations that came out related to our bail bond reform, but also as it relates to procurement. And we are taking a look at our ethics laws in the city of Atlanta, which right now are really some of the toughest and most stringent, certainly in the state and across the country. But even as stringent as they are, there has to be another layer to make sure that when you have bad actors, that it does not spoil the entire bunch. So this transition team and this subcommittee will be twofold. One, we are launching a search for a new procurement head, along with several other searches in the city of Atlanta, including HR director, fire chief, general manager for the airport. There's a lot of movement and transition, but also really to give us best practices across the country so that we can make sure that our procurement standards not only do we have the standards on paper, but to the extent that there is someone who wishes to color outside the lines, if you will, that we have a process in place and we have layers in place that can catch any improprieties before they begin. It's also important to note that as we operate with the City of Atlanta, so much information that you all have certainly, that you've read about in the newspapers and you've seen on television has come to light because of open records requests. Each day I have a meeting with my communications team and the bulk of that meeting deals with some request that has been made. And again, what my charge has been to my team is, and our city attorney and I were talking about this before we came in, is really pressing the reset button. After 8 years, fatigue sets in. It sets in with the media, I believe, and it also sets in with an administration. But pressing the reset button, that this is a new administration and we will have a new relationship and a new approach as it relates to how we exchange and deal with information. And I recognize that I'm still in the honeymoon period. Usually when I get up to speak, and I'm really surprised you all didn't stand up and clap for me. But you know, people are still excited because of the newness. So I understand that we haven't gotten to that level yet with many of the clashes, and hopefully we won't get to that point. But I am certainly committed and have asked my administration to be committed to being open and transparent. Because what I do know is what is done in the dark always comes to light. And I want to make sure that we are not inadvertently sending the signal that we had anything to hide. I know that the U.S. Attorney is doing a very thorough job of searching through all of our records, but I also want to make sure that we are transparent in a way that keeps us really honest, if you will. I think that the media does a great job of keeping us thoughtful. So when certain records are requested, it may be for a particular department, but it may send a signal to another department that you need to be more thoughtful about how you are retaining your records or how you are transacting business. And the other charge that I have given the team within the City of Atlanta is, even though there are things that we have done a certain way for the past 20 years or the past 8 years, it doesn't mean that we can't do things differently. So while there's a lot of movement in the leadership team in the City of Atlanta, we do have many of our leaders who are holdovers from previous administrations. And I always give the example of Frank Blake when he took over Home Depot. My husband works at Home Depot. Frank Blake worked under Bob Nardelli for many years, and part of his responsibilities included buying up multiple companies on behalf of the company. And when Frank Blake was elevated to CEO, one of the first things he did was to begin to sell off all of these companies. And I give that example because what it said was he was a great employee under the previous CEO, followed his direction, but it was not necessarily what he thought would be the best course for the company. And what I said to all of our department heads is, even if this is the way we've done it for any number of years, if it's not the best course for the City of Atlanta, tell me that we need to do it differently. Tell me how you think we need to do it differently. And that really is what I ask of each of you. And you all are obviously interested in transparency because you are here today, but if there are things that you feel we should do differently, because at the end of the day, I am the CEO for all of you all, for the City of Atlanta. Tell me how we should do things differently. Tell me what best practices you see across the country. If you are part of the media, tell me how you think we should interact with you differently. Because we want to make sure that we are doing what's best for the City of Atlanta as a whole. And then lastly, I wanted just to touch on a bit, and Chris mentioned this in the introduction, the transfer of the deeds to the Atlanta Public Schools. I mention that because you all are a group of lawyers, and I know that you paid a lot of attention to that. But again, I think it really speaks to the direction that we are trying to go in as a city in terms of pressing reset with all of our partners. And we are not yet even 60 days into the administration, but we've already done some things that certainly, I'm sure, resonate with each of you all. One, the transferring of the deeds, which there were some happy lawyers who made a lot of money working on that project, I'm sure. But also, as it relates to criminal justice reform. And again, these are initiatives that really came from the public and from the community saying, this is how we want to see our government operate. So please keep the ideas coming. Keep asking the great questions. And hopefully when I stand here next year, we'll be able to celebrate many more wins and many that I will be able to give each of you all credit for. And with that, I will answer any questions that you may have. A group of lawyers with no questions.
Oh, we have one over here.
Well, I was sort of, what little, I don't live in Atlanta, so, but what little contact I've had with city officials, it seems to me there might often be some sort of a suggestion box to address rudeness on the part of a city employee. So, if, for example, you go in to get a building permit and it takes, and somebody is basically, is rude to you, that you could somehow or another put that in a box someplace and it works its way through the process. Because I think that's the kind of thing that undermines people's love of government is when they have individuals treat and rude. I had an issue at the jail many years ago where somebody got out of the personal recognizance, but it took 8 hours for her to get out. And so, and it's kind of like, even though she had a lawyer there, I could see and infer from that how rudely people were being treated by the jail personnel back then. That was 8 or 10 or 20 years ago.
And that's a great suggestion, but I will also say keep the emails coming. There was a time, and I can't say it's been recently, but I read and responded to every single email that I received. And I sent them to department heads and asked for follow-up accordingly. So to the extent that there's any issue in the city of Atlanta, big or small, keep those emails coming. My email address is kbottoms@atlantaga.gov. But when you send an email, especially when you send it to a department head, you will get a response.
Any more questions? Ma'am.
Thank you so much, and I'm so excited about your first 100 days. It's been very impressive. You've come in and you've said, this is what I'm going to do, and doing it. The city of Atlanta is actually really small. Is there a way we could do like listening tour, not like listening tours, but like to connect everyone in the city? Because I think that's something that's missing, and I've been so impressed with what you've done in the first 100 days. I'd like to bring us all together.
That's actually on our to-do list. I'm glad you asked about that. And again, this goes back, I give Home Depot as an example. My husband is a recovering lawyer. He's no longer in the legal department. He's vice president in HR now. He flies around the country and has town hall meetings. And he was flying to San Jose, and I said, why can't somebody just tell you what's happening? And he said, because if I'm not sitting there, it goes through the middleman. And what it reminded me of was the importance, even as a city council person, is sitting in front of people directly, getting feedback directly. So one of the charges to my team is that we are going to do town hall meetings, not citywide town hall meetings, but we're going to break them up in quadrants of the city so that we can dialogue one-on-one. I did it as a city council person in what I thought was a very productive way. We would have all of the department heads present, police chief, fire chief, not, any department head that we could get there. And we would take questions from the audience on cards. Then afterwards, we would do breakout sessions with tables. And what I found is early on, when I just sort of let it be a free fall, the meetings would go on 3-4 hours, and it didn't feel as if I'd gotten a lot of the information or my constituents had. When we did it in a more formalized way, we would end in 1 hour and 45 minutes, and people less satisfied because their issues had been addressed directly. So that's something that we will be doing citywide. So stay tuned. The other thing that we will be doing that you will hear more about, there were a lot of racial dynamics in this campaign and a lot of discussions about race. I've had many people ask for some type of city initiative around discussions on race and where we are as a city. So that's something else that we are working on, and you'll get some more information on that too.
Can I say something? I think it'd be cool to do it with the Auburn Avenue Research Library, because that's such a jewel, and not enough people know about it, and they do amazing programming. So I didn't mean to, I think those both sound great, thank you.
We have a question right here in the front row.
Would you talk about transportation and timing of streetlights and filling of potholes?
I'll start with potholes first. If there's a pothole, please call 311. If you ever see a pothole, get the nearest address, nearest intersection, and we are supposed to fill that pothole within 72 hours. I'll tell you another effective way. People tweet me, all of tweets and me tweets on potholes, and I send it directly to our public works commissioner, and then miraculously they get filled as well. So we just need the nearest address so that we know where to send the crews, but that should be within 72 hours. Transportation is our hot button perennial topic in the city of Atlanta. There's a bill currently pending over at the state legislature where I've spent, it seems as if every day since I've been elected, discussing various issues, the airport and transportation being a big one, on how we approach transportation from a regional perspective. Chairman Tanner has a bill pending that will do some restructuring around MARTA and GRETA and the governance board. We're not completely aligned, but I'm very happy to say that we are listening to one another, and we will see where that bill goes this year. The interesting thing, and again, it's really, traffic is awful, we know that, but there's really an economic case to be made as we approach transportation regionally now. What our neighbors are now seeing is that we are having so many wins within the city of Atlanta, especially attracting corporations, because we have a transportation network. MARTA may not be perfect, but it's pretty darn good. And when companies are looking to relocate, they want to know, what's your transportation system like? That's one of their number one questions. So when you have neighboring counties that don't have a transportation network, they really are eliminated before the conversation even begins. And so with part of Chairman Tanner's bill, we're looking at funding mechanisms for a regional network. But meanwhile, we have TSPLOS that was approved by the City of Atlanta, City of Atlanta voters. And we have a lot of projects coming online in the city of Atlanta. Between Renew Atlanta and T-Splash, you're seeing a lot of street repavings. You are seeing sidewalk expansion. You'll even see a lot going on as it relates to the Beltline. I had an interesting meeting with our head of the Beltline yesterday, and I was thinking back to the beginning of the campaign. I talked a lot about extension of light rail, because I think it needs to be extended throughout the city. But even in the last year, things are happening so fast. There are some light rail alternatives that are really getting a lot of traction. They aren't buses, and it's not as expensive as light rail, that we may see used throughout the city of Atlanta as well. I saw a really cool picture of something between a bus and a train from China on yesterday. So it's a top of mind conversation, even in areas where it didn't appear that it would be. But everyone's talking about transportation. We all recognize that it's a problem. And I think the fact that they are talking about it over at the state legislature really tells you how seriously people throughout the state are taking this issue.
Are
are we doing anything on signal timing?
Signal timing, yes. We have, we're working with some of our corporate partners on traffic light synchronization, and I had this conversation with Ambassador Young, I see Andrea here, and what he shared with me is, we've done this multiple times. I said, well, why do we still have a problem? And he said, because the city is still growing. So if you don't tweak it each time you build a new building and you do a new development, then you have continuous problems. So that's another issue that we are working on from the city of Atlanta, also working with some of our technology partners so that we can create an infrastructure that it won't be such a heavy lift each time to tweak it.
We have a question right here from the young lady in red.
Mayor Bottoms, I'm glad that you're here. Trinell Thomas. I have a two-pronged question. One, Atlanta has been listed as one of the fastest growing aging populations in the country. So how can we have the city to take on that task, to pull together all of the many different organizations and responsibilities that are addressing the aging population, to synchronize those plans and thoughts? The second pronged of the question is that Atlanta has been listed as one of the most disparate cities in the region. And how can we begin to bridge those gaps and resolve some of those issues?
Thank you, that's a great question. So part of what my transition has entailed is looking at how we are organized as a city and these touch points that aren't necessarily outlined in our city charter but certainly should be of concern to us. We currently have a chief equity officer in the city of Atlanta who does great work, but I've already begun to expand that office, and it will be called the Office of Equity and Inclusion in the city of Atlanta. We'll be looking at a number of issues, including the affordability issue in the city, including this income disparity that we've read so much about, LGBTQ issues. You go down the line, we have a whole team that we're filling out just to focus on those issues. Then the other area that I am expanding our reach to is, at some point, we will have a director of public health in the city of Atlanta. The reason that's important, as we're talking about issues related to our aging population, so much of this falls under the purview of Fulton County and DeKalb County, but it's certainly of interest to us as from the city. And even with, I announced that I was looking for a director of education, again, an issue that's not under the purview of the city of Atlanta, but certainly impacts our communities. And I think that it's just important that we have someone designated, whether it be a department or a person designated on focusing on those issues. Our seniors are a tremendous asset to our city, a huge part of our city. And I think it's important that we help coordinate services, especially with our other partners accordingly.
Thank you.
One right back here.
I have a question about development, which is so closely tied in with transportation. We're obviously seeing a huge influx of population into the city proper. And I'm just wondering, I know Mayor Reed brought in a very, from my perspective, just serving in a couple of meetings, public meetings, a really innovative and forward-thinking planning commissioner, Tim Kaine, and been part of an effort to address our aging zoning ordinance, which has been around forever and is so antiquated. We've got buildings going up everywhere. It's great, it's exciting, all these new neighborhoods and like the same little roads. Will Tim Kaine stay? Will that effort to rewrite the zoning ordinance go forward?
Yes, so we are still working on the zoning rewrite, and I wish I had a camera the day I met with Tim. I told him, I want you to give me some new ideas. Even if you've been doing it this way for the past few years in the city of Atlanta, if you think there's a way we should do it differently, let me know. Tim's face lit up, because Tim has worked for several mayors. He's very accomplished, and certainly is very thoughtful about planning in the city of Atlanta. And something that Tim did that I really loved, when we had our transition meeting, he brought a list of headlines from the AJC and various publications on Atlanta. This list of headlines, one included something on inequality in Atlanta, a number of other issues. And then he listed what we want those headlines to be. And it really, for me, helped crystallize from the planning perspective and from my perspective where we are and where we need to go. So Tim is a valuable member of our team. I'm looking forward to working with him and looking forward, really, an exercise that I did in my last cabinet meeting was a little unconventional. I asked each of my cabinet members present before we left out to answer two questions for me. I said, I don't care if you're the planning department, the fire department, the finance department, the law department. What can your department do to address affordability in the city of Atlanta? What can your department do to address gang violence in the city of Atlanta? And the reason I did that, because I want us, whether it's planning, and Tim's a planner by nature, of course, but I want us to start forward thinking on how we're all working together to achieve these common goals. And so much of it goes back to our planning department. What I've said, I was asked once, one of my greatest, if I had to give a regret for my time in office, what would it be? And it was that I was not more engaged with the planning department, because I didn't really, I couldn't conceptualize what they did and why it mattered, because there were so many immediate needs, but so much of it is about forward thinking. And we know that many of the issues that we're having in the city with development has everything to do with where we are with our zoning ordinances.
We'll start with the young lady in the back.
I don't know if this is a city or county issue, but if it's a city issue, what are your plans for taking care of the food deserts?
For the food deserts? I think it's all about balanced growth and development in the city of Atlanta. Part of, I was executive director at the Recreation Authority when we sold Turner Field. And part of that process and that planning process was, what was it that the community wanted, what did the community need, and sitting down with the people who were looking to redevelop the area, it's a huge food desert. And what I've said as it relates to traffic, as it relates to our schools, as it relates to our planning department, is that we really got to start looking at these issues holistically in the city of Atlanta. The natural inclination, I believe, is to continue to build where there's growth. So you see it on the east side, you see it in Midtown, you see it in Buckhead, but there's still areas of our city where we are still struggling for the very basics, where we're struggling for quality food, where people don't go grocery shopping in the corner 7-Eleven. Those are still true needs in the city of Atlanta, and I think that it's important that as we continue to grow, that we really strongly encourage and incentivize our developers to go to other areas so we can address issues, not just our food deserts, we have healthcare deserts in the city of Atlanta. We also, I believe, are struggling to really balance out as a city because of where we are with our schools. That when people are looking to move to the city and they have a young family, one, if they can afford to live in the city, that's a big hurdle. But secondly, where can they educate their children without having them to send them to private school? Or where can they live where they can walk to a grocery store? So it's a huge need, and it's top of mind as we're working with developers in the city.
Sir.
Mayor, about the people who are sort of on the ragged edges, people who are being displaced, homeless, families who are homeless, what kind of programs are going to be developing?
We are still working with our partners as it relates to the homeless issue. We've had a lot of success in the area of veterans homelessness, and we have achieved what we call effective zero for homeless veterans, but certainly there's still huge needs in the city of Atlanta. The model that we are really moving into from the city, especially since we closed the Peachtree and Pine shelter, is not just housing people in the city, but making sure that those services that they need to break the cycle are available. And this model really is one that when you ride past a shelter or supportive housing, you should know that it exists. And many of you all know where the Imperial Hotel is on Peachtree Street. Well, most people don't know that that is a permanent supportive housing. So in this Imperial Hotel prime real estate on Peachtree Street, we're providing services at the doorstep to help make sure that these formerly homeless people aren't homeless again, that they have all of the support services that they need. And that's how, you know, we're really following the lead of our community partners and stakeholders with that, and making sure the other piece of that is not having concentrated shelters in any one area like we've seen previously. The goal is to make sure that we have supportive housing in the 12 districts throughout the city. There is an entire group in my administration. The deputy CEO who was over that group just transitioned out, but there's an entire focus from my administration, an organization that focuses on the homeless issue. And it comes out of the COO's office, not CEO.
Sir, go ahead.
Some of the more successful interventions in some other cities in the youth gang violence and connection to the planning city,
with employment and youth gang violence? Was that the question?
There have been some successful interventions in other cities that reduce youth gang violence to make employment.
Yes, so the short answer is yes. We know that a huge amount of the crime we're seeing in the city of Atlanta related to our young people is related to gang activity. Part of that requires a great deal of coordination with APS, which we are working to maximize that. But again, going back to this director of education, part of that will be to make sure that we are being a good partner so that we know where we're needed in the city of Atlanta. Meaning, we have a summer job program in the city of Atlanta. Well, clearly that's not enough. But I don't know that we can say this is the other portion that's needed as it relates to job training and vocational training. And what I heard repeatedly from the unions, and I'm hearing this even from our corporate partners, that they are finding success and looking for success really to get people involved and engaged, especially in the area of vocational training, in a high school pipeline. So the reality is that many of our young people will not go to college, but when you have Delta Airlines that will be hiring, and I'll give them as an example, thousands of airline mechanics who may make $85,000 a year, then that may be appealing to a young person who's not interested in going to college. The other part, and I was having this conversation with our fire chief, is they are also trying to create a pipeline with high school students. And the reason was interesting, because they need to catch them before they put tattoos on their arms and on their faces. Because if you have a tattoo on your arm or your face or somewhere that you can see it, you can't be hired by the fire department. So often if they wait until they're 18, it's too late. So they have created a partnership with the Atlanta Public Schools. And I mentioned our fire chief. Our fire chief is retiring after 30 years, and he started with the city of Atlanta in his early 20s. And so there's certainly a lot of partnerships that are needed in that workspace, but I think that we have to have a focused attention on it. And my hope is that between our director of education partnering with APS and knowing what the schools are, the needs are, and also partnering with our various entities within the city of Atlanta will be able to address those issues in a tangible way.
Sir.
Mayor Bottoms, I'd like to know, what, if anything, are you doing to support and further develop arts and culture in Atlanta. And when I spoke to you briefly a few weeks ago, you mentioned people on your transition team, such as T.I., Kenny Leon, Virginia Heltner. And when I reflected on that, I realized that those are very successful people in our community, but they don't necessarily represent most of our community. And I don't believe that many of the voices and the people who supported you are represented. That's been my observation, and that's been my observation for a number of years. I don't know if you're aware that I was chairman of the Fulton County Arts Council, and it was one of the current concerns I had there. So the question is development and in an equitable way.
Certainly. Well, the transition team is only 38 members, so it would be impossible to have everyone who was supportive at the table, but there is a separate group that is aligned in the city of Atlanta dealing with many of our progressive issues, which is where the recommendation on criminal justice reform, bail bond reform came from. Several other recommendations, they are several other initiatives they are working on. And I think that you would find that group, although not as high profile, is certainly probably more reflective of many of our community voices, if you will. Secondly, as it relates to arts and culture, the way that I've addressed this transition, there are tiers of issues, all important issues, but there are these immediate needs, immediate issues that we have to address. And I have been very careful not to spread us too thin, because I want to make sure that we're able to focus and have success accordingly. But I did find it important to have thought leaders, if you will, at the table to reflect different areas. And in fact, when I was filling out the transition team, I thought that the arts and culture piece was not fully reflected in our transition team. So that's why you see of the 38 people, there are four thought leaders in that area, because it's such an important issue. But there are issues that are very timely right now for the transition, meaning we have to have a new search for an airport chief and a fire chief and an HR chief and a procurement chief. And then there are these other issues that are equally important, but our subcommittees will address accordingly, whether it's arts and culture or any of the other number of issues that I've spoken about. So it may not be top of the list. It doesn't mean that it's not top of mind. We just have some very pressing things that we have to address with a limited amount of resources.
Do we have another?
There's two over here.
So you mentioned the legislature a little bit, and you talked about transportation and two coming together. One area relating to the airport is a bill being talked about that would put a committee, oversight committee, on top of the airport and the airport authority. And one of the arguments being made for that is government transparency. How do you feel about that? Is that going to be a step forward for the airport and the city of Atlanta?
I hate it. about it. And I think that, again, we are not perfect as a city, but our airport is still year after year after year ranked the world's busiest, most efficient, and all the other accolades. So we're doing something right as it relates to our airport. And my concern, as you're talking about a governance structure, changing our current governance structure with the airport, we've had so many wins with the structure that we now have in place. It's not happenstance that we are a finalist for Amazon. And it's with the current governance structure that we have in place. There are also many other really legalities that would make a change not beneficial to the state. Part of it is how we structured the agreement with Delta Airlines with the leadership of Mayor Reed is when we redid our lease agreement with Delta Airlines, there were a lot of things put in place as it relates to our bonds and debt service, et cetera, that would make it very costly for us to change the structure. Delta Airlines is aligned with the City of Atlanta and its current structure. And Ed Bastian, who's the CEO, is a part of my transition team. And it really, in my opinion, is about continuing to have solid leadership at the airport and having leadership and having trust in our procurement process. I don't think there's anything wrong with our current governance structure. I just think that we have to provide more confidence that we are being good stewards of the airport.
Yes, ma'am.
To fulfill
your objective,
so the way that we are going about this, my transition team is broken up into various subcommittee and various search committees. So we are working with some national search partners to do nationwide searches on these positions. And also, I've tried to be very thoughtful as we have broken up into these various committees to not necessarily have people align as it relates to, I'll just give an example. Carol Tomei, CFO of Home Depot, is on the airport search committee. She helps lead a gazillion dollar corporation and certainly can be very thoughtful about the type of person that we attract to the airport, which generates millions upon millions of dollars in revenue. So I just wanted to make sure that we had very thoughtful and successful people helping to lead these searches, because I recognize that I'm a lawyer and I may have blind spots as it relates to what the airport leadership should look like. So I wouldn't want that decision to rest with me alone. I want to get input not just from our partners who are conducting the searches, but also from a team of people who operate in this space, in this organizational space. Meanwhile, we have, with some of the departments that we have people who transition out of, we have interims in place. We have a good pipeline of talent in the City of Atlanta, which is part of the reason the entire investigation that's going on right now is really frustrating. We have over 8,000 employees of the city in the City of Atlanta who by and large get up each and every day and go to work and work really hard and make an honest living. And it really cast a cloud on the City of Atlanta and our workforce when we have people who aren't doing the right thing. So I just want to make sure that I'm getting input from an array of people as I make these decisions as to what our leadership should look like throughout the City of Atlanta.
Thank you, Mayor Bottoms. If you all would join me in giving her a round of applause.
We're going to have a break now. Let's see, political rewind starts at 2, so we should be sure we are back in our seats before that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.